I'm going to go over a number of learning theories and how they apply to the use of technology in the curriculum. Specifically, I'm going to present 12 learning theories for integrating technology. I'm going to discuss the learning theory briefly and provide some technology examples for each theory. And here are the learning theories I'm going to discuss. Social learning theory was developed by Albert Bandura, and basically the idea is that Bandura was describing the kind of learning that you engage in or participate in while observing and watching others perform. Small children do a lot of that learning. They're looking around and watching their environments and learning from that. It's somewhat passive. And they go through various stages of paying attention and remembering what's going on, reproducing that behavior, and when they're successful, being motivated to reproduce again. So what kind of observational learning occurs with technology? Well, certainly indirectly, if you participate in an online discussion, over time you pick up the behaviors about what's going on, how to interact in a polite way, in an effective way. And that would happen also in a community gaming environment if you were playing games and figuring out what was going on and learning in that environment. And the same thing applies to a blogging community, which is similar to an online discussion. Or it could be a Facebook page where you're actually responding and getting responses and figuring out the kinds of posts that are produced and what's acceptable and what is not acceptable. So I'm referring to participating in these kind of communities and learning sort of from the back channel and the culture of what's going on in the actual behavior, not being explicitly taught anything. Next, let's look at cognitive load theory by Sweller. And so what Sweller did is a number of studies and found out that our working memory, which we probably know intuitively in our short-term memories, are limited. And if they're overloaded, we cannot learn well. We can't focus. And I think we've all felt that, where we can be overloaded in what's coming through and therefore nothing is learned. So the moral of the story is to process in smaller chunks. Make sure you have the pre-knowledge to pursue activities. You're systematic in terms of what you're doing, and you try to minimize distractions. And it is related to elaboration theory and going from the simple to complex. So how does that look in technology use? Well, if you currently take a look at Khan Academy, the way they actually are structuring their videos with follow-up questions, and then they give hints, and if you don't get a question right, they offer you some suggestions, and then they repeat questions. There's sort of this awareness that you have to proceed step by step, and they're organized step by step. And they're small steps, small enough steps, so that the user isn't overwhelmed and can review. Same kind of learning that occurs in Code Academy when they step you through learning code a little bit at a time, starting with the smaller bits and processing and not just overwhelming you with a lot of code. And again, with gizmos, which are online learning tools, they contain the environments and there are a restricted number of variables to play with so that the user isn't overwhelmed when they're trying to learn and explore. In situated cognition, the idea is that knowledge is embedded. Not all knowledge, but a certain degree of knowledge is embedded within a culture or a context, and that learning is social within that context. So situated cognition can certainly occur in a community of practice or cognitive apprenticeship, which we'll talk about a little bit later. So what does that look like in terms of technology use? Well, there are a number of examples. For example, building electronic circuits, an online tool for doing that. Being part of a do-it-yourself community where videos and suggestions are provided about specific activities that people want to do. SuperBetter is a tool that actually focuses on building up problem-solving skills and resistance. So it's a really a real-world tool situated in real-world experiences. Udemy is a set of courses that involve a community and are situated within a very specific context of learning. Flight simulators, for sure, are definitely situated in a context, as are online dissections or online operations. So there's a real context, and in some cases with the do-it-yourself, communities in terms of learning within a real-world authentic situation. Communities of practice involve groups of people who share a passion for something and learn it better with the interactions that they have with each other. So they literally, there's a community, there's a shared domain, and there's a specific practice that they engage in, or a set of skills that they engage in. And it's clearly related to situated cognition and real-world problems. So what kind of technology is involved in communities of practice? Well, there's LinkedIn communities where discussions can go on, edublogs, flipped learning nings, sort of like Facebook, where there's interactions going on and questions being posted and people responding, e-pals throughout the world in terms of groups of students engaging with each other in communities, video conferencing with classes and communities back and forth, and taking it global, which is similar to e-pals, and engaging in global communities. Connectivism is less a theory and more a way of describing learning through new opportunities created by the internet, which involves multiple sources and perspectives, and generally refers to MOOCs, or massive open online courses, and problem-based learning. So it's the kind of learning that would occur in a MOOC, online free courses that are offered by organizations like Coursera, edX, and Udacity. And these are courses where thousands of people can sign up. There's lots of input, lots of perspectives, and lots of ways of interacting and getting information. The next theory is behaviorism, and it's learning through positive or negative reinforcement, usually from an extrinsic source. It's often used to learn basic skills, because typically as educators, we want students to have intrinsic motivation when they learn. However, with basic skills, sometimes it's hard to get motivated, and so positive and negative reinforcement is used. So in technology, you might see something like IXL, where students answer questions. If they get them right, they move on and get points. The reward, if not, then they go back and have to do more questions. That happens in things, in learning objects, very content-specific ones. Even the name says it, where you're learning bite-size bits of information, and you get rewarded when you actually get the answer right, and cheers, and that sort of typical positive reinforcement. And if you get things wrong, you have to redo them. You might even get a sort of a negative sound. And those are similar what you would see in PBS Kids, usually for younger kids, Kahoot and Prodigy, which is the rewards are probably more involved in getting through a very long but interesting sort of adventure game.